Welcome, everybody, to the November 9th meeting of the Hadley Select Board. First item of business is the consent agenda. So just reading through the items that are on the consent agenda this evening, we are not going to be approving the October minutes, but we do have warrants payables 1719-2, 1720S, and 1720. We have a request for appointment for the Pioneer Planning Commission. That is John Michkowski Sr. as an alternate representative. We have a request to appoint to the HPAT Advisory Committee John Allen and the Ambulance Committee George Moriarty. Select Board is prepared to award a bid for Phase 1, which is the site clearing for Zaterka Park. And then there's a designer selection procurement for the senior center and the fire substation design work. We also have 3 one-day liquor license requests. First one is Top of the Campus for November 17th, a one-day liquor license for Top of the Campus on February 3rd, and a one-day liquor license for Wine and Canvas on 4 dates in November, the 12th, 18th, 19th, 26th, and all of these would be conditioned on are subject to any conditions that might be set forth by the building inspector, fire chief, or chief of police.
So moved.
Okay. Second.
Okay, so first and second in. Any discussion on any of the appointments or any of the other items this evening?
John, you'll be the alternative. Who's your alternative to?
Bill Dwyer.
Thank you.
Okay, David?
For the Zaterka Park bid, we're recommending Omasta Landscaping as the lowest responsible and responsive bidder.
Okay. All right, thank you. Sorry, should have read that. Okay, motion made and seconded.
I would like to hear a response from the station manager of HPAT. He sent out lengthy emails to everybody that he wasn't satisfied with that appointee, so I'd like to hear it from him exactly what the situation is.
My only concern with John Allen is his lack of availability to attend meetings. He's only available during the day, and then when you combine the schedules of the other committee members, it results in them only being available to meet on a Friday afternoon. Fridays are my busiest days, and it's hard for me to take the time away from my work on a Friday to attend a meeting. Also, I find those meetings to be rather stressful, and it blows my concentration for the remainder of the day. So, and also, you're appointing him to the Oversight Committee, not the Advisory Committee. The Advisory Committee doesn't exist anymore.
The Oversight Committee, yep. My guess question is it worth trying it out to see if it could work, and then deal with the scheduling issue later?
Yeah, it sounds like he had spoken to the rest of the members, and then Mr. Moskin sent another email down the line here.
Yeah.
That I had just read today.
Mm-hmm.
So it sounds like the whole committee has worked out. Know.
I say one more thing. Also, with them limited to only being able to meet during the day on a weekday, it's going to make it a lot more difficult than it already is to recruit new members to that committee, because most people work during the day.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess the question is, do we want to defer the appointment and have further discussion, or do we want to go ahead and allow the appointment, but then perhaps we should be having a conversation with the Oversight Committee at some point soon anyway? Just kind of talk through.
All right. Mr. Moskin's letter.
It seems it would make sense to have the committee come in and listen to the members if they can work it out or not. It's only hearsay this way.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to see if they can work it out. If Mr. Allen can't make it any of the meetings in the evening and they can't make it during the day,
yeah,
it's a wasted appointment.
Right.
So if they could come in and explain to us what the situation is, I think that would help clarify everything.
I have no problem with that.
Okay, so are we moving forward with the appointment and then asking them to follow up, or are we going to defer the appointment until we have a conversation with them?
Where are we going with it? You're gonna try it out for a couple of months and see how it works out?
So what?
Do they have a suggestion?
Mm-hmm. David?
So you have the appointment, these are annual appointments, so they would be up in June. So there would be an opportunity for you to revisit this in May and June of next year, 2017.
Right.
We have a number of things that are coming up that are, we're gonna be relying upon HPAT to perform, partly being able to respond effectively to the new requirements of the public records law,
mm-hmm.
as well as our enhanced communication plan, which is part of that required response. So if we have people who are willing to put in the effort in order to help HPAT be part of an overall solution to a requirement that's imposed by the state, and considering that we have this appointment for, call it 7 months, I think you should go ahead and do it.
Okay. I mean, I'd be inclined to do it on a trial basis, and I, to Donald's point, I think we should still, you know, try to get the HPAT Oversight Committee on the schedule at some point, and talk through with them what their.
I don't think it's hearsay either. I think we have the letter from Mr. Moskin says the HPAT committee members believe the Friday lunchtime meeting makes sense to them right now. So I don't think that's hearsay.
Okay. All right, so there's a motion made and seconded then.
The only other question I have, I think, is does Richard still have an assistant now?
No.
So how can he do his work and go to a meeting and no one's there to take care of the office?
He could take
the meeting is in the office, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
And he can take an hour during the day to have a meeting. Mm-hmm. It's part of his job.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't think that that's any big deal.
Okay, motion made and seconded on the floor. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No?
Okay. That's for the whole consent agenda?
That is for the full consent agenda.
Okay,
yep.
And I will abstain from the John Allen appointment for right now.
Because of your mom?
Yeah.
Yep, okay.
But all the other ones are all set.
Okay, good. All right, we have some time for a public comment period. Joyce, I think you have.
Jane.
Oh, go ahead.
No, go on.
Yeah, go ahead. No more.
Oh, okay, just a few. A few little dillies here. Our condolences to the family of Patricia Bai and to the family of Joseph Bach on their passing. Also to the family of Arella Boresca, which would be Kenny and Han's mom and Larry. On her passing recently, this past week also. On a happier note, the girls' soccer team won their co-league division title this year, and the golf team won Western Mass team title, as did Caleb Farnham win the individual league title, and this is his second one for his career at Hopkins. And the boys finished last night. They had a good season. They played Lennox last night and lost, but thank them all for a good season.
Jane, did you have?
I do. I have a public announcement. Monday coming, November 14th, Friends of the Hadley Council on Aging are having a fundraiser. It's our first annual trivia night. It will be held at Mitiera. Mitiera has kindly, in terms of their service to the community, donating all the profits from the food to the Friends. Plus, we're having the trivia night, so people enter the trivia contest, and that money will go to the Friends. And their cash prize has been donated by one of the sponsors. One of your board has been a sponsor and is providing food for the tables for the players, not for people coming to eat, but for the players. And we really hope you'll all come. And to that end, I have a little flyer for each of you.
How does a trivia night work?
A trivia night works in that there is a trivia master who is used to making up questions for trivia games.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. And so you have a team of anywhere from 1 to 5 people. It costs $5 a person to play the game. And you get your little team, and so then the trivia master said, who was the first president of the United States? And you all huddle together, and you write down an answer. And at the end of halftime, the trivia master scores those, and then you go to the second half, at which point there are more questions, and then the prizes are awarded.
Okay. Okay. Anything else for public comment? Okay.
I'd like to ask for an explanation. In the public forum in the week previous to town meeting, I stood up and asked about whether Article 6 was binding the plans to the site next to the village hall.
Mm-hmm.
And so I brought that question to the board on that night.
Mm-hmm.
And then when town meeting came around, the motion was not printed out beforehand, whereas it was for other articles. So I'm wondering if that was just an oversight or why it wasn't printed out, if it was a conscious choice to do so, or like an explanation of that. And I just wanted to, you know, lodge a complaint that I think it's unfair to the voters to not have that information be more clear. And particularly because I brought the question up the week before, why was it not printed out that night?
Yeah. Public comment, we typically don't respond.
Okay.
So can we get
stay
back?
Stay with that and bring it to the next
yeah.
meeting.
Yeah. Okay. Bring it to next meeting. Okay.
Next meeting. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, sure. Okay. So if there's no more public comment, I think we have a few minutes before our tax classification hearing. Would you like to? Yeah?
Sure.
Okay. All right. So our police chief has the next agenda item. He has some appointments for us.
I'm going to stand if you don't mind. It's warranted. It's a bit of a historic occasion.
Come on in.
Got a lot of our officers, basically people that are working. So. I apologize. I'm going to read because I wrote some notes on it. I didn't want to forget anything. But first thing I would like to do is thank all the folks who came out to town meeting last month and voted yes for us to make the much-needed expansion to our services at the police department. This new plan is not just a way for us to curb overtime, as we've talked about a lot, but it's a step towards giving us what we need so that we can give the people of Hadley what they deserve as far as police services go. With these new changes, we will soon be establishing a detective position, a school resource officer, a community policing officer, and even a traffic officer. We were able to present to the select board and the Finance Committee a budget plan that was supported and in turn the voters of Hadley agreed with. We will, I'm making a promise that we will continue to work hard to earn our citizens' trust both financially and otherwise. With that said, with your permission, I'd like to present two candidates. Unfortunately, only one was here when I offered the position to him. He smiled, and then when I told him the day that he would have to be here, he almost cried because he's on a trip that he had pre-planned. He tried to change his flight but could not get back in time. So I'll talk about him first. Alan Ash is his name. He came to us in 2014 and has worked as a special police officer since that time. He is in the Air Force Reserve and actively serves as a senior airman. When he is not on a mission, he's always working odd hours at our department to cover gaps in our schedule and has continued to demonstrate that same dedication throughout his employment with us. He completed the previous hiring process that we had a short time ago and was ranked at this potential position by the hiring committee. Based upon that, I would recommend to the board that Alan Ash be appointed as the first of our newest full-time officers.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on that? Not?
I'm asking questions next time.
That's right. We'll grill them another time. All in favor of appointing Alan?
Aye.
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 Thank you. In front of you have Officer Courtney Call. Courtney came to us in 2015, and she currently works as a full-time dispatcher at UMass, and she actually came to us with some substantial law enforcement experience as a part-time police officer in Belchertown. She has also demonstrated her dedication to our department in this town by working very odd hours. Even while she was assigned the 7 p.m. to 3 a.m. shift at UMass, she would often be found racing down Route 9 to get to our department to cover the final 4 hours of a patrol or a dispatch shift in the middle of the night.
Racing is figurative, correct?
She also completed the same previous hiring process and was ranked by that committee for this potential position. Based upon those factors, I would recommend to the board that Courtney Call be appointed as the second of our newest full-time officers.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I think I just have one question for both, though, because it just wasn't said in the statement, which I'm thrilled to have you both. It's nice to expand our department. Academy-wise, where are we?
Right now, we are beginning our new hiring process right now. We're going to bring on some more specials, part-time officers to fill in the ranks of these folks when they move up. We also have that potential third full-time officer to fill that last spot. We could very well potentially be sending 4 officers, which is kind of required by the MPTC guidelines, to the same academy this coming June. So I know we've spoken about it ad nauseum. I wasn't able to obviously give that information. I was able to give it to the board and to the finance committee, but the folks in town may not know it all. But when that time comes, that's one of the reasons why I have asked for some time to put this plan together, because unfortunately Courtney and Alan will be able to start very soon, which will fill some of our gaps as far as the overtime goes, but then in June we'll be losing them again. So we will need some time to put this plan in place. We made the cuts that we did to the overtime to show folks that we can be trusted with the money that we have now, and hopefully the plan that we gave the select board and the finance committee will show that we can be trusted with these new officers moving towards the future. But we will unfortunately have to be sending them all to most likely the same academy.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. So is that all that you have?
That is all that I have.
Could I ask the chief to repeat what you said about your injuries at the staff meeting? I see you have one of them here that still made it, but to inform the rest of the board members that weren't at the staff meeting.
Yeah, we actually, there was one point in time, if you start maybe 2 months ago, where we were actually down 4 officers. We had one officer who had left for another position, and we had 3 officers that were either injured on duty or injured or had to have some type of surgery off duty. That puts us down by 3 in our full-time ranks. With the new positions coming on, this was what we were planning for, is that if we have the additional staffing, those shifts that are vacated by our injuries will not always have to be filled. That's where the savings comes in.
So Courtney, on behalf of the select board and the residents of Hadley, welcome and thank you.
Same on the streets.
Thank you all. Can I borrow him for 30 seconds?
Sure. We can continue with that.
Okay. Is Dan here?
He's here. Dan is here.
Okay. So we have a 7:15 appointment for a tax classification hearing. Thank you, officers. And so we should be seeing, there he is.
The entire force was here.
Perfect time.
Saw Mr. Schauer, too.
Yep. Have a seat up here.
Yep.
Hot seat.
Front row.
Okay. All right, welcome, Dan and Mr. Mish.
Mr. Schauer, Mr. Grohan.
Up, there's Mr. Schauer. Right. Well, this is the our annual meeting with the assessors. So, Dan, do you want to start? Or?
Sure. Each year, the select board needs to vote whether to have a split rate
or a single tax rate, whether to grant an open space discount, a residential exemption, or a small commercial exemption. We had a report, it's been up on the website for a couple of weeks. I'll just go through it real quickly. The first step is the allocation of the tax levy, which is whether to have a single rate or a split rate. This year, if we go with a single rate, our tax rate will be $11.57. That's up from $11.15 last year. If the maximum shift were adopted, the rate could drop as low as $8.46, and the commercial and industrial rate would increase to $17.36. The average house this year has increased to $313,700. Our values haven't changed. It's more a factor of higher end homes being constructed in town. So many $600,000, $700,000, and $800,000 homes came in. It raised the average value of all the properties by about $2,000. So house, if there's a single rate assessed at $313,700, will go up approximately $152 this year on the taxes. On page 4 of the report, there's a chart that indicates 5 commercial properties and 5 residential properties. These are the same properties that we've used the last probably 20 years in the report. And it shows how much the property, how much their taxes would change if you implemented a 10% shift. The commercial would go up approximately 20%. This commercial is roughly 1/3 of the town's total value. So any shift in residential lowering, you would go up twice as much on the commercial than the industrial. On the open space, we currently don't have anything classified as open space in town. Typically that would have been swamps, ponds, lakes. When DOR came through, been 15 years now. In our 2002 reval, they had suggested that we get rid of the open space classification and just classify it as either commercial, industrial, or vacant, non-buildable land. It didn't really have an impact on the value. The residential exemption, that was changed this year with the Municipal Modernization Act. In the past, it's been 20%, up to 20% you could give it for an exemption. Now it's up to 35% of the average residential assessed value. That in Hadley, the average residential assessed, that includes vacant lots, is $283,597. So it's just under $100,000 would be exempted. In Massachusetts, last year there were only 14 communities that granted a residential exemption, and most of those are the high-end resort communities on the Cape that have the high-end $20, $30, $40 million estates on them. If you were to adopt the maximum exemption, a house in town assessed at $385,700 would pay slightly more in taxes than if you didn't adopt it. And because the tax rate would go from $11.57 to $15.58, but you would basically take $100,000 off, similar to the way that CPA is calculated. And the small commercial exemption, there are, according to the DOR, Department of Employment and Training, there are only 28 properties in town that would qualify for this exemption. In order to qualify, they would need to have less than 10 annualized employees and be assessed for less than $1 million. If you were to grant the small commercial exemption, that that tax money is made up within the class, the commercial class. So the tax rate would go from $11.57 to $11.96. And I just want to point out on page 8, our levy limit this year is $10,975,832, and if a single rate is adopted, the unused levy capacity will be $2,292. And if there's any questions.
Okay. So just so to be clear, the recommendation from the assessors?
That's on page one.
Yep.
And the board is recommending a factor of one, which would be a single tax rate, no open space discount, no residential exemption, and no small commercial exemption.
Okay. All right.
Just got a couple of
sure.
quick questions.
Go ahead, Don.
First one's a real hard one. I want to ask Mr. Shala, how many years has he been an assessor, Donna Hadley?
I forgot.
But actually, how many years?
Well, since 1966.
66. Wow. That's a long time. I have to get out the calculator for that one. Secondly, I'd just like to commend the board, you know, for the effort that you put into this. It's very difficult. I'd love to see, you know, the residents in town lowered, but our business district is really taking a hit right now with Amazon.com. Everybody's ordering stuff online and getting free shipping, and I would hate to see our businesses see any increase at this point in time. And I'm glad you did look at it, but you didn't consider it.
Recommend we adopt the assessor's recommendations.
Okay. So there's a motion to adopt.
I'll second that.
Second. Okay. Any further discussion? No. Okay. All in favor?
Point of order. Since this is a public hearing, are there any comments from the public?
Yes.
Any comments from the public?
No.
No.
Okay. Then.
All for it.
Hearing none. Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
So that would be 50 years for Mr. Jala, since nobody can do the math.
Yeah. Dan, something else?
The normal paperwork that you would sign for this is not complete.
Thank you.
Because the recap is not done, but hopefully we'll have it for next week's meeting.
Okay. You know, we're looking for candidates for the town report. I think Mr. Jala would be an excellent candidate. He's never been in the town report to be honored for his services.
No.
Maybe that's something we can consider.
Sounds good. Okay, all right.
Okay.
Thanks very much. Appreciate all your work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is North Hadley Village Hall. Okay, so David, this is. You put this on the agenda just as a follow-up to the vote on town meeting floor relative to the substation.
Right, so this is a scheduled vote. We had talked about having a purchase and sale agreement signing in November.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that we talked about with Mr. Greenbaum. But since we made that schedule, we also had the special town meeting in which we passed a number of articles associated with North Hadley Village Hall. Most notably would be the construction of a fire station on the ball field at that location. I spoke to Mr. Greenbaum after the vote. He understands that the select board have to feel their way along on this, but he's still interested in purchasing the property. So we have an offer that's still on the table. We have a town meeting approved article which still has to go to the ballot for the construction of the fire substation. On the consent agenda tonight, you approved the green light for going ahead and fleshing out and issuing the designer selection procurement for the design of the building contingent upon funding, which would be contingent upon that ballot vote. So that's where we find ourselves at this point.
Okay, so we need to make a decision on whether or not we're going to be moving forward with Mr. Greenbaum.
Why we need to make that decision before we see the layout for the fire station?
I didn't say when, just say, but that's the reason it's here, is that we do need to take action because we do have this
I think he's
going to
probably want to see it too. We're going to continue negotiating with him or go up a bit again.
I think the proper time to have that would be after we have the design for the fire station and we know what we have and what's available and see whether or not it's still something that he's interested in.
And the next question, or the second thing on the agenda after this, is the debt exclusion vote, which, you know, I think plays a factor in it also.
David, when you were speaking with Mr. Greenbaum, did you talk timing with him?
We didn't talk about a particular schedule, but I did say that we would have to begin talking about how we're going to focus our energy on North Hadley Village Hall, starting with this meeting. I think he understands if the board needs to take a little bit more time, given that you have other decision points to make along the way.
Yeah. I mean, it certainly does seem to make sense to have the...
Well, the debt exclusion vote is scheduled for January 10th, I believe.
Not yet.
Well, we haven't...
No, but that's what the projected date is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, as somebody spoke earlier, that this could be contingent on that vote, too.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important if we, the townspeople, vote for the debt exclusion.
Can't get it the first couple weeks in December.
I'm more inclined to vote on this after we have the design for the building, to see what actually is going to be available, make sure everything fits, et cetera, et cetera, and let him know exactly what we're looking for. I don't want to waste any more of his time, our time, anybody else's time, until we see exactly what that building looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Where the square footage is, if he's going to have 13 feet off the building, if he's going to have 28 feet off the building. I think that's all predicated on his decision-making process.
But my understanding of the situation, he wants the whole lot, not just half of the lot. If he wants the whole lot, that changes everything. He hasn't said anything about just the building and so many feet north of it, has he?
He's made two offers. One was for the building and not the ball field, and the other one was for the entire lot, which would be the building and the ball field.
This is recently, or what we talked about before, the initial $40,000, and then he added $60,000 to it to make it $100,000 for the whole lot.
Right.
Is that what you're referring to?
So I'm referring to that, those offers which are on the table. So it's a $72,000 for the building and not all the property, and $100,000 for the building and the property. Those are still on the table.
Do you have an answer if he'd be interested in the building and only the 50 feet north of it and not the ball field with it?
Well, that was his original proposal.
Yeah, but then he changed his mind. He wanted the whole lot.
Right.
So would he be satisfied with his original proposal? We don't know that. I would like to get that information from him.
I can nail that down, but he did put that request in writing.
Okay. And I think that would help us to make our decision.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that's imperative, I think we have to discuss the new truck coming and allowing the fire chief to make the repairs there. Even if it's only temporarily, we don't know, but we have to have a place for that fire truck to go. Not the new one. The new one is going to Center Station. We know that. But the one that's coming north doesn't fit in it, and we can do that for $5,000 and buy a lot of time. So I think we should give him the permission to go ahead and get that done, because it looks like we only have 2 to 3 more weeks before the new truck arrives.
So the board has already given us authorization to spend $5,000 on the building, so we can proceed with that if that's the wish of the board. I know that the fire chief arranged for storage space at one of the malls, and we're also negotiating with a property owner in the north end of town for rental space up there. Just a little bit of commentary on the timing of the designer selection. We would issue the designer selection procurement now, contingent upon funding in January. The award would be in January, and then the design would be finalized sometime during the winter and early spring of 2017. So, Mr. Bryant, if you're comfortable
you're
with that schedule,
you're not
going to
see it anyway, Jerry. You're going to see the proposal that they put in front of you. You're not going to have the actual plans of it anyway. Not even in January.
I agree, but I wouldn't sell a building until I have those plans.
No, I understand that, but the way you sounded like you wanted to wait until the plans for the station were here.
No, I'm waiting for the override.
Okay.
Right.
Well,
so
that's what I mean. So move that up to the beginning
vote?
Of December.
Yeah.
Why can't we move it up to the beginning?
The override vote's not until January 10th.
No, he's saying why can't we move
it up? Why can't we move it up? Who set that date?
Oh, I don't know. Why can't we move it up?
So are we moving into the next item?
I don't think so. I think we...
Okay. So the rules on the override is that they can't happen any sooner than 35 days from the town meeting, and no later in a special town meeting than 90 days. So that gives you a window of December 1st to January 25th. We looked at available dates for the Hopkins Academy for an election, and January 10th turned out to be the most convenient time for everybody's schedule.
Even with the school closed over the holiday season?
Right, because there's some sports events going on.
So it would seem to me to make sense until we know the outcome of the override vote.
Well, that's all I was saying. Just move it up to the beginning of December, or when the kids are out of school. If there's any way of getting it in December.
The override vote?
Yeah.
I trust that's been vetted already.
So if we hold off on any further action until the results of the override vote, whenever it winds up occurring or known, then... obviously, if the override vote doesn't pass, that's very different information for the conversation with Mr. Greenbaum than what we have right now. Mm-hmm. And if it's moving forward, then we'll have a much better sense of...
You know, why I'm thinking about moving this along a little bit quicker now, the people have already spoken twice. If we get a chance to sell the building, that'll take another article off annual town meeting for next year. Mm-hmm. Because they went to move that along, what we were going to do with the building anyway. Mm-hmm. So why are we dragging our feet?
Well, I heard David say is that it wasn't that people are trying to push it off. They're just looking for an available date where it makes sense to have it. Right. So nothing in December worked, is that correct?
Yeah, December doesn't work. January 10th was the earliest that we could find a schedule that would fall on an election day. We could push it off to January 24th.
No, he's looking earlier.
Yeah,
earlier,
not later. Yeah.
That's, you want to go later.
Right.
So,
I would make a motion to allow the fire chief to go ahead and make the reparations on North Hadley. It isn't going to affect the sale of the building with Mr. Greenbaum.
That's
there's
been done.
Hardly going to be any changes.
Right, but I think we already did.
That's all done. It's been done.
Well, we gave him the money, but we didn't tell him he could go ahead and start the repairs. Did we?
No.
I don't believe we did. We voted the money to do it, but we never told him he could start the project.
I think what we're looking for is just what is the decision of the select board. We don't want to invest in a building that we're going to turn around and sell.
Mm-hmm.
So we're happy to move forward with that if you wish. You've already given us the green light.
Renting somewhere else is going to cost us a lot more, and doing that we can buy the 6 months and we'll get all that money back that we don't have to pay for rent. The building committee is already preparing the building to do that. I don't know why we want to hesitate and not do it.
Now, is Mike indicating, because Mike was doing a lot of maneuvering with the equipment and the storage with the Hampshire Mall?
The only equipment he's moving out is antiques and things like that. No trucks are going to the mall. Just, you know, the wagon there that was pulled by horses, things like that,
mm-hmm.
and other equipment that they don't use in the building, but no trucks are going to the mall.
Right.
So how about if we do this as an action item? I will talk to Mr. Greenbaum and say that the decision of the board is to wait until the results of the election.
Mm-hmm.
In the meantime, we'll make the modifications to the building that we need to. We'll use the remainder of the operating budget in order to heat that portion of the building through the winter. And I think we can pick this conversation up in January.
Does that work for everybody?
It does. Yes.
Okay. So,
they're going to need to blow out the water lines and stuff like that in there. But.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I know there's another part to this which has to do with the ZBA, but for now we'll take just this one. Do you want mm-hmm. an actual motion on this?
No, I think that's what I'm going to do.
Okay.
Unless
right.
you're telling me not to.
Yep. Okay, everybody's in agreement on that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, good.
I thought we were wanting to move ahead last vote anyway, so.
Okay.
Got a question?
Yep, sure, go ahead.
Mr. Greenbaum, what is he doing with that building?
Is he complying with the zoning laws?
That is not something that concerns us. This building was offered for sale as is with no representation or warranties of any kind, so.
I'm pretty much concerned what he's.
Our planning board will take care of that. You guys will take care of that.
So I'm just also reading on the agenda, it says that Mr. Michikowski is going to request permission to apply to the ZBA for whatever relief required to construct and operate a fire substation.
Well, last time that setback should have been done, whoever wrote it out left it out. So it's, there are two things that'll be done. The 50-foot setback and the 20, over 2,500 square foot in overlay district has to be voted in by them for variance.
And do we need to do that before the override vote?
Absolutely, get that out of the way.
Okay.
So it would be scheduled, whatever meeting they got. So if the board does it, we'll write it all out and you guys sign it. Is that okay?
It would be, it is.
Yeah, now the town meeting's voted on it. Is everybody comfortable moving forward with that?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah.
David, any?
It's an application to the zoning board of appeals for a variance. If the town decides to take a different direction, then.
No harm, no foul.
No harm, no foul.
But just something that's done.
All right, so that's fine. Do you, we need a formal vote on that? Or no?
Yes, please, yes.
Okay, so I have a motion?
So moved.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. All right, then the next agenda item we have, are we all set with North Hadley Hall for now?
Two other things. We want to hit up the Conservation Commission and also a presentation with the Historic Commission with the concept of the building, where it's going.
This is the task force, the subcommittee?
Ad hoc?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so you want our agreement to?
Right, just, you're okay to go do that.
I have no issue with that. Okay, everybody comfortable with them continuing the process? Okay, that sounds good.
Is that a motion?
Somebody want to make a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, then moving along, the next agenda item we have is the ambulance subcommittee. Mike really wasn't needed for this, but right now we're resurrecting the ambulance task force that was formed several years ago. The mission of this group, however, will be a little bit different. I think the last time through, we went through and evaluated really from scratch all of the different options available. The intent of resurrecting this group is to have it be a working group or a working subgroup that will bring all of the data current and look at what our options are in the context of the Amherst contracts coming up for renewal another year out. So right now on the subcommittee, I believe we have myself, Joyce, Barbara O'Connor, who's a former select board member and public safety chief. Is that her title?
Hank Barstow.
Yep, Hank Barstow.
And George Moriarty.
And George Moriarty tonight.
And Chief Specknibble.
Right, and I think the one request that the chief made, at least to me today, was to make sure that we offer a seat at the table to someone from the finance committee. I mean, it'd be very good to have somebody there engaged as well. So he wanted permission to do that. He was thinking about reaching out to Amy Fiden. Okay.
Sounds good, yeah.
Okay, so I think at this point it's just a matter of getting scheduled.
Well, that'll be five, so that's.
Does that work, yeah?
Because George is on it too, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he was on a committee before also.
He was.
Okay.
So what's the makeup again now?
So.
George?
Yeah, Chief Specknibble.
Barbara.
Me, Joyce, Barbara, right, George, and then Mike, Hank Barstow. And then with the finance committee member, that actually would bring it up to seven, I think, but it would be an odd number.
Who would be voting members?
Voting members of the group? Well, I mean, it's really a work group, so.
It's more like the ad hoc committee. They're just going to bring all the information to us.
You're not going to. vote on anything, we're just bringing you the facts.
Yeah.
Yeah, it comes back to the select board. So I'd imagine that will result in a presentation similar to last time with a recommendation of the.
Options, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so I don't think we no need to
Action.
Take any vote on that unless we need to again formally vote to offer a seat at the table to the finance committee representative.
Would you welcome some help in setting up the inaugural meeting of that? I know that we started talking about this back in July.
Yeah, that would be great. I mean, Mike's, you know, obviously he's been extremely busy with the work on the substation, let alone his day job. So he's at a point now where he feels he can get this committee started again. But I think that would be very helpful, David.
Okay.
The only thing I need is some clarification on Mr. Moriarty. This is the father that was the captain at one time?
Yes.
Not the son?
Correct.
Okay, and it wasn't stated here at all.
Okay.
And I just wanted clarification.
George is the father, his son is not George.
Right. Okay, then moving along, debt exclusion ballot date and form of questions. So we've talked a little bit about this, but David, do you want to?
So January 10th is the recommended date for polling hours from noon to 8.
From noon to 8?
I'm sorry?
From noon to 8?
Noon to 8.
Is that a mandate?
You have to have it open for 8 hours. So that's the mandate.
Right. But I know that question's come up before with the town clerk, and I believe she said that it was a decision made by the town that the special, that those would be the hours.
Mm-hmm. That's a long-standing practice.
Right.
Right.
Because many people have asked, why can't we do it from 7 a.m. to
Yeah, or 8 10 to 6 or something for in this
yeah.
particular situation.
I mean, our experience is
noon, they'll get there.
Yeah.
The experience is that we just don't get the traffic before noon for a ballot question vote.
Okay.
So 8 hours is the minimum requirement.
Okay.
There are 8 ballot questions approved by the October 27th town meeting for the vehicles, the MS4 stormwater update, two HVAC ones, the computer IT for the school, one HVAC for the school, one HVAC for the public safety complex, the municipal levy system, survey work, the subsurface work there, the fire substation, and the senior center for the council on aging. So the form of the questions are set by law, so we don't have a whole lot of room to play with the language. This would be notice from the board to the town clerk to schedule the referendum, set the form of the questions, and set the time of the voting.
I think we went through this before too. You know, for the sake of the people that weren't at the special town meeting, to put the amounts in on these?
We can't put the amounts in there. It's not allowed by the Department of Revenue.
Can we do a handout in advance that explains? Because this, I understand what John's saying very clearly, that without any amounts here, people are going to try to understand if they should be voting for some of them, not some of them, and that kind of thing. So
right.
I think we should work awful hard to get some type of handout available for people to fully explain before they vote on these issues
right.
what
so,
they're voting for.
So what I think
we still got a question from special town meeting right now that we got to deal
right.
with. You know,
how can you spend public money to encourage a ballot question?
Explain, so, not encourage. Explain.
David, go ahead. You were saying something.
Yeah, so I think that obviously we want to do a lot of outreach and education to make sure that people fully understand the questions that are being asked of them, the work that's being proposed, and the amount of money that we're talking about. Unfortunately, the Department of Revenue doesn't allow us to put the dollar amounts in the referendum questions, but there's no reason why we can't talk about this in every single meeting from now until January 10th and post the information on the website. That would be simple enough for us to do.
Okay.
And if you would find it helpful, I can run through the amounts right now.
No, it's not for me that I'm looking
okay.
for. It's for the public.
Okay. And again, maybe we can try to get some help from our friends at the Gazette.
Yes.
To get it published.
We can.
That would be you.
Yeah.
We can run this ballot on our cable access with the amounts on.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So then it's pertaining to the question, the amount. So
right.
That they can research it that way.
It's not
right.
Advocating.
We can certainly educate. We can't advocate.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So do we need a motion on this?
I need a formal vote on this, please.
Okay.
Before we do that, I've got one question.
Sure.
Can we segregate the police cruisers from the public works? I'm afraid if people go in and don't want to give the public works their equipment, we may lose the two police cruisers,
We
need drastically to be done.
That was my other question, to separate everything individually.
So the answer is yes, you can up to a point. You will multiply the number of questions that are in front of the voters. You have 8 of them right now, which seems like a lot. I talked to the Department of Revenue. You can separate out questions so long as you're talking about like borrowings, because we have to pattern this on the motions that were passed at town meeting. So, for example, you could combine the two HVAC systems together into one question. You can separate out the vehicles from the cruisers from the DPW equipment. But you couldn't, say, combine the HVAC and the IT together. That doesn't work.
Just separate them all.
That's the only problematic area I see, is the police cruisers and the Department of Public Works new equipment. Everything else pretty much takes care of itself. But I'm very adamant about not losing those police cruisers.
So I recommend against making more questions. I do recommend that we present the questions in the same form as we pass the motions.
I'll make a motion to separate them all.
All or that one issue?
All of them. Because you got the two air conditioners separate. You've got the drainage separate. You have the senior center separate. You have the fire station separate, substation.
So you're taking the one equipment one, you're taking one question and making 6 out of them.
4 or 6 or however many there are, yeah. There are
4 pieces of equipment and 2 cruisers.
Is there any chance we can get you talked into doing just 2 there, the police cruisers and the town
DPW?
You know, I'm inclined to agree with Mr. Wiskevich. We got an education when we tried putting the backhoe on the ballot and it got lost until we educated the people. You know, I don't want to lose everything.
I know it's a pick and choose situation, that's what you're looking at, but rather, and Donald's right, unfortunately, rather than losing it all, put them individually and let the people pick and choose if that's the way they feel.
But we're just talking about that one equipment article. Yeah. Equipment question.
Everything else is separate. So.
So you're just talking about the DPW and the police cruisers.
Right.
That's no biggie. One more question.
That's 6 questions.
Because yeah, there's additional pieces of equipment in the DPW, not just one piece of equipment.
There's 4 pieces.
Yeah. 4 and 2 cruisers. But the cruisers would be one question.
Well, but the DPW things, this was part of capital planning, wasn't it, Jerry? And that was their recommendation was from the capital planning committee.
Well, John, is that a motion? I mean,
no, he made a motion. So you want to separate everything, though?
Yeah.
Right.
But 5 times, right? 2 cruisers on one
and
4 individuals?
Yeah.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. Any further discussion on the motion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All
opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Done.
I'll separate it twice, DPW and the
that's what I'm thinking.
And the cruisers.
Yeah.
I'll make
do
a
that.
Motion for that, too.
No, I'll second your motion, Joyce.
Okay. So motion made and seconded to separate the article, to isolate the police cruisers on one and then the DPW equipment collectively on the other.
Yes.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Take care of that. Anything further? Or do we need to actually vote the whole thing now?
I believe we're done.
Okay, but do we?
Do you need the recommendation on the,
Yes,
the date?
So we need to rewrite this and send it to the clerk. So if you could take that motion, if you could take that vote to notify the clerk of the polling hours, the polling date, and the forms of the questions to be amended as per your.
What were the hours?
12 to noon to 8. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I don't like the 12 o'clock.
Yeah. I don't either, but
I don't think it gives people enough time that wanna go to work or whatever in the morning, and some don't get home until late at night either if they travel.
Can you early vote on that?
You can absentee ballot on this one.
Yes, you can. You can absentee ballot on that.
And maybe that's information we need to get out to people to encourage more voting.
Yeah.
Because
along with the information, we should put that on TV5 also.
Exactly.
And it's vacation time too.
Yeah.
Right. And a lot of people do travel in January.
I'm gonna vote no because I like different hours.
What would you like? 8 to 8? 7 to 8?
7, yeah.
Whatever you want to do, but I think.
Well, has a vote been taken? It was 4 to 1.
Spending a lot of resources on not a lot of return.
Yeah. I think we focus on the education and letting people know what their options are for now, and then see if that works better.
I'm just saying.
Yep. Okay, so we have a 4 to 1 vote on that?
Yeah, I just want to make sure we get this on Channel 5 with the amounts on it for information for the people that were not at a special town meeting. Yes, we will make sure it's in there.
I just wanted to make a quick comment that a lot of folks these days no longer have cable. So, on the website too, it's.
Yeah. Our local newspapers, maybe, you know, we can get it in an article in.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if we know anybody that knows how to write in a paper. We got one guy here in the front row.
Okay.
Believe it or not, we still read it.
I do believe
that. Jane?
So if the questions on the ballot do not have numbers associated with them, how does a question read?
The questions read, so for example, for the senior center.
For example.
For example, thank you, I like your choice.
Shall the town of Hadley be allowed to exempt from the provisions of propositions 2.5, so-called, the amounts required to pay for the bond issued in order to design and build a senior center for the Council on Aging, yes or no?
Okay. And then early education will say what number we're looking at.
Right.
Okay.
And all these questions I wanted as non-binding questions a year ago.
Yes, you did.
I wanted to make that point.
Yep. Nobody ever listens.
Okay.
Could we possibly have the town administrator do his report? We put it off for the last 3 meetings because of time elements.
Yep, I've just.
And there's a lot of pertinent things on there, and he could probably make it quick, but there's a lot of things he should speak about.
I completely agree. Yeah, so I was just going to say, David, could you hit to Donald's point the highlights of the.
Thank you, I have it.
Okay.
Appreciate that offer. Just for the clarity of the record, I'm sorry, I was distracted. You took a formal vote, is that correct? Okay.
4 to 1.
We did 4 to 1.
All right, thank you. All right, so I'm just going to touch on a couple of items here. I guess the first one is the election. 2016 early voting was a success, with about 20% of the electorate casting their votes in advance of November 8th. When the final tallies were taken, in excess of 80% of the voters turned out and cast ballots for in the town of Hadley. So better than 80%, I think that's.
How many voters was that?
That's about 3,200 and change.
Voted?
Voters came out to vote. All right, I don't have exact figures at this point. Unfortunately, Mass Department of Transportation decided that yesterday was an ideal day to pave the intersection of Routes 5, 9 and 47. And it created a lot of inconvenience and confusion as a result. We were on the phones working with our legislative delegation with Mass DOT to get them to clean up the situation as much as possible. We regret very much that there was an inconvenience to anyone trying to access Hopkins Academy or the town hall. We thank you for that high voter turnout, despite the decision by the state to do some paving. We were told that they would be paving today, so that was in our schedule, so we were notified very late in the day on Monday that that was going to happen on Tuesday. And you should see my emails. It's like, really? Voting day? This is the day? I'm just going to touch on a couple of other issues here that we've had a conversation with the attorney for the Department of Public Utilities on our energy aggregation project. The hearing with DPW is coming up next. Hadley's application is in good order. And once DPU gives their approval, Good Energy will conduct a bid process for electric rates for residential customers. And assuming a favorable outcome, which we'll be bringing back to you, then Hadley residential electricity users should start seeing discounts in their energy bills. Bay Road Bridge Project, they're still working with the environmental permit. That's still in process. But funding for the bridge has been secured. The contractor has been given the go-ahead to get the order the materials, and we're expecting a 6 to 8 week window for the delivery of those materials. So hopefully they can get going on that bridge sooner rather than later. We will have a conversation with Mass DOT, given how they messed up our election day. Maybe they can make up for it by accelerating this bridge project.
Start to finish, what's the estimated time frame?
I don't have that for you, and I'm not going to guess.
You're smart.
All right.
Not with them, you're not.
Public safety complex roof update. The notice to proceed has been sent, and the work will be completed in the next 180 days. Let's see. The public safety committee has submitted a grant for $15,000 for emergency signaling for the police and fire vehicles along Route 9, something that we don't have, so that will be a very welcome addition to our ability to respond to the trouble on Route 9. And that's about it, just some upcoming projects and events. North Hadley Sugar Shack has their tractor pull this Saturday. You already mentioned the trivia night for the Council on Aging on Monday. Mother's Club, and I know, Jerry, you have more to say about this, so I won't steal your thunder.
Okay.
There's a crafts fair at the Hadley Farms on Sunday, November 27th. Ballot for the Senior Center Fire Station and all the equipment on January 10th. An annual town meeting is coming up on May 4th, 2017.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Great.
I just,
hey, go ahead.
If I could just, I'd like to report back from the Municipal Buildings Committee. I polled them and I asked them how they liked the forum, if they thought it was worthwhile. They thought it was worthwhile, but would have liked to see an addition there with possible anticipated questions. I think we've been through enough town meetings to understand what's going to be coming out for questions. If we could have, at the forum, kind of introduced the answers to those questions, they felt that would have been helpful.
Mm-hmm. That's good feedback.
There are a couple things that's very specific for them. They're very concerned about making sure that the budgets for the buildings, for the maintenance of the buildings, gets addressed in the annual town meetings. It's one thing they're going to be pushing for hard so that the buildings get taken care of. And they think there's a significant amount of money that we spend post-problem to taking care of the buildings. So they're gonna be working with Marlo, and inviting Marlo to the next meeting to try to set up what he feels, they feel, Gary Berg feels would be appropriate maintenance setups and developments for the buildings. And based on that, they're gonna try to come to us on, in the spring to try to develop a meaningful budget that addresses taking care of these buildings before they get to a point where it's hard to take care of them. So I just wanted to pass that along. And they were concerned, they were just wondering when the date was for the override, so I'll be able to report back to them the date that we have here.
Okay, good.
Anything else, Mr. Danlinkle, did I leave out, sir?
Well, it's all in every building. We're gonna be monitoring not just the apartment, DPW, but all the buildings, and set up a list of jobs that need to be done, should be done, and the cost, approximate cost of what those will be, so that when they look at it, they'll know that this place has to be painted this year, and the windows done this year, and the floor is sanded and sealed, and these floors black every month, and so on and so forth. Little odds and ends like that, that all add up to quite a bit of money if you look at it. But we're looking to give that information to the selectmen so that they can see how much money we're going to need every year just for the window washing, the floor washing, and the toilet cleaning, and so on and so forth.
Okay. All right. Anything else on the town administrator's report? Okay. Okay, so if not, we have our last agenda item for the evening, which
Jerry,
is...
Do you want to go with this?
Oh, well, we still have announcements afterwards.
Oh, okay.
Which has to do with a complaint that the select board received. And I think we have some people who probably want to be in the room.
I just wanted to announce that Hadley Mothers Club 7th Annual Holiday Fair, November 19th, 2016, is going to take place at the Hopkins Academy Cafeteria on Route 9 between 9 a.m. and 3. Contact Donna Berg if you have any questions regarding it. Come shop, visit Santa, lunch menus, silent auction, hourly door prizes, bake table, Red Cross Bloodmobile. Please bring a non-perishable food item for the Hadley Food Pantry and receive a free raffle ticket. For the entertainment that they're going to be having there, the Hopkins Academy Jazz Band will be playing between 10:30 and 12, and dancers from the Duffy Academy of Irish Step Dancers are going to be there between 12 and 12:45. The Hadley Girl Scout carolers are going to be there between 1 and 1:30, and Santa arrives between 1:30 and 2:30. So it's always a great event, everybody, if you could please help the Mothers Club. All their donations go to wonderful projects in the town of Hadley. Thank you.
Thanks, Jerry. Okay, so the next agenda item is relative to the complaint that we received.
Madam Chair, can I ask for a brief five-minute recess?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Okay. Not very good TV.
No, I know. anything else going on that we can talk about in town?
I'd like to do a little song and dance.
Yes, I forgot to mention the second NextAmp solar field has gone live October 25th, and we have a next net metering credit agreement with them to save 16% off of part of our electrical load. So over the next 20 years, we expect to be saving a substantial amount of money on our electricity.
And that is where?
That's over on Mill Valley Road on the Allard Park.
Up and running?
Yep.
Got a tractor thing. Is this Saturday?
Tractor pull.
How are you?
Good, how you been?
Not the tractor.
You expect to see again so soon.
David, how are you? Great to see you. How's everything? Been a while.
Hey, David.
What was the date? You know, that Santa thing? That sounded like
It's November 19th.
Okay.
Next weekend. So. How's everything in Boston?
Crowded.
Crowded?
regular crowded or more crowded? I gotta be there in the morning, so it's scaring me.
The Hickory Council is set up at Dyer-Tyler today to take care of people. The election.
They said between Baker and Warren, we're in some trouble. We better not have anything go wrong in the state of Massachusetts.
No grant funding for us.
No.
Yeah.
They always said that because we always support the Democrats and Republican gets in and we're lose a little money, but they.
That's when Nixon closed the base, so.
Yeah.
Westover.
Yeah. Guess the turnpike is free now, so it looks good.
Free is not exactly the right word, is it?
Yeah, 4 days it is.
Now?
Make that fast.
So you came right through on it today?
Well, yeah, they have the electronic.
Yeah.
Thing, so.
But they do in New Hampshire on one side.
They have to break down and get a transponder.
I would think so.
Not too last minute, right?
No.
No, yeah.
Nice open.
I like it because even going to up to Maine and stuff, you go through New Hampshire and there you just go right through. Well, one side, they still have the side you can still pay.
Right.
Yeah.
Someone down in New York are 60 mile an hour tolls too.
It is in New Hampshire.
I think down in Hamden Beach is, yeah.
Oh, 95
down
miles
at Stewart
an
Airport
hour.
In New York on 87 is like that
65
also.
65 miles an hour.
Yeah, I'm not sure I prefer to know. It only takes me a half hour to get out here.
Yeah.
If they use the electronics to track.
Don't worry, they'll send you a ticket along with the bill. For a toll, I'm sure.
Eventually.
Just one thing for the board. I know we have an awful lot coming up in the month of November, so it's very possible next week we may be talking about whether or not we need to have one more meeting this year.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that council? So I just wanted to, it'd probably be a good idea to give just a summary of where we are right now. So the select board received several complaints about Mr. Pipchinski's actions at the Young Men's Club in Hadley on October 15th. And the board called for an executive session for October 26th. At Mr. Pipchinski's request, the board did reschedule the executive session for November 1st. On November 1st, the board convened an executive session. And Mr. Pipchinski, as is his right, stated that he wanted the matter discussed in open session, and that request was granted. By letter to the town council for Mr. Pipchinski, Mr. Thomas Rook had requested another rescheduling in order to prepare, which request was granted to November 9th, which brings us to this evening. So the board now is opening this meeting in open session as requested by Mr. Pipchinski, and the topic of tonight's meeting will focus on the events of October 15th, 2016. The board expects to consider the written record concerning the events. The board does not expect to call witnesses, and the board does not expect to cross-examine any witnesses. This is not a hearing, it's a meeting.
Madam Chairman, may I ask if any members of this board or members of the Young Men's Club?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
Auxiliary, I'm not a voting member.
At this point, then I would ask that they recuse themselves from sitting in this meeting, that they remove themselves from the room due to a conflict of interest, that they're sitting members of the Young Men's Club. I want to still remember that they should not be participating in any sanctions or any recommendations that may adversely affect Mr. Pipchinski.
May I ask whether or not any of the members have filed previous disclosures with the town clerk's office regarding any votes with respect to the Young Men's Club?
I have not.
Such as
no.
Liquor, anything
no.
like that?
No.
Do any of you have a direct financial interest in the club?
No.
Do
no.
not.
Okay.
I haven't been there in over a year, so I mean, I don't even go there. I just.
Well, obviously something like this is a conscience vote, so if you feel that your participation in the club would cause you not to be able to look at the materials in an objective and fair way, and if your conscience compels you to recuse yourself, then that's a conscious decision. I don't think that the law would require you to recuse yourself where there's no direct financial interest by any of you, but I would recommend that if you decide to stay and participate in the discussion and the deliberations, that you file a disclosure statement with the town clerk forthwith, which would state that your membership in the club, so far as you know, would not affect your ability to act on this matter.
Madam Chair, I would still make my recommendation, make my motion that they recuse themselves. They have not disclosed to the town clerk their previous affiliation with that club. They have made votes by members of this board on affecting that club, and in the interest of the word transparency, which we've all heard about for the last 15 to 24 months with the presidential campaign, I think in the interest of transparency, being honest with your constituents who vote you into office, it is imperative upon you to recuse yourself from this hearing so Mr. Patinsky can get a fair hearing and the citizens of South Hadley understand that there's not bias.
You're in the town of Hadley.
Town of Hadley.
And this isn't a hearing, it's a meeting.
So, it's all semantics. If the members are going to take a vote and they have any adverse effect on Mr. Patinsky, they should recuse themselves.
Well, and just real quickly, the rule of necessity comes into play here, because if three members of the board leave, then there's no quorum, and the board would not be able to act. So in addition to the disclosure, I would advise you that the law of necessity would permit you to
stay
in a situation like this.
Right. Note my objection for the record, please.
Absolutely. Okay. So do, and again, this not a member of the club, so do you feel that you can continue?
Thank you.
John, are you as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Madam Chair, also as a matter of procedure, I just heard you state that the individuals who submitted these letters are not going to be present tonight?
Correct.
So Mr. Patinsky and myself will not have an opportunity to ask them any questions?
Not this evening.
I would raise another objection of basic constitutional due process rights and the Massachusetts Bill of Rights. And Mr. Patinsky, through counsel, does have a right to question individuals who are putting his character into question. And those individuals are not present. You, as members of this board, knew well in advance this hearing was going to be held tonight. You had an opportunity to invite them, or to instruct them to be here, and you haven't done that.
Okay. Did you request their presence, counsel? Did?
I'm not the one putting forth the charges, ma'am.
No, I'm just asking. I didn't know that there was no request.
I did through your town administrator. I asked for the names and addresses as witnesses. I was told that, not sure what the response was, but you're the person's putting forth these charges, whether you want to call them a charge or an allegation based on a letter. We have the right to ask those persons questions, other than looking at the four corners of a letter that was submitted. We have a right to request their presence. Yeah, this is an open meeting. There's no whispering involved.
No,
the state has to be stated on the record.
Exactly.
Right.
You might stating on the record what you just
absolutely
whispered to the chair.
Absolutely. I said we can also state, we can also ask for a continuance of this meeting if we, you feel like we need to have the people brought in that had written letters.
My client has a constitutional right to confront individuals who are making allegations against them. That's your decision how you want to proceed with it.
And attorney, one moment, I just have a question for town council. So this is not a hearing.
Correct.
This is a meeting. The point of the meeting was for the select board to point out to Mr. Pipchinski concerns that we have about certain behaviors. Granted, they're alleged behaviors, but I'm not necessarily following the necessity of allowing, for a courtroom, sort of hearing session here.
Right.
So could you clarify for us,
sure,
please?
What counsel is arguing is there's several kinds of due process requirements that may attach to a hearing like this.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there's a procedural due process issue where a person has a property interest in a position, and in order to deprive them of that property interest, you're required to give notice and hearing. So for example, if you had a town employee, a police officer, whoever, that you were going to contemplate discipline, you would be required to go through a hearing process. That's not the case here, because I don't think that Mr. Pachinski has a property interest in continued employment, a property interest in his status as a Board of Selectmen member. The other circumstance, and this is what I think council is getting at, is that Mr. Pachinski has a property interest in his reputation. And the argument is that he has the right to a hearing, a name-clearing hearing, for the purpose of restoring his reputation. Mm-hmm. He has not requested a hearing up to this point. He was on notice through the notice of executive session that this was a meeting rather than a hearing. He has not requested a hearing, so hearing procedures are premature at this point. If you get through this and Mr. Pachinski wants to elongate this or feels that he has the need to confront the witnesses, then that's something that you could address when you receive that request. Mm-hmm. So my recommendation would be that you go forward with tonight's meeting.
Okay. And
my concern, my response to that, is in the notice of the meeting, there was no indication what consequences might result from that. So if this board makes any, has any intention of making a vote tonight to refer this matter to any state committee, the Ethics Committee, Mr. Pachinski should have been advised of that in advance. It was, so this was a meeting. Mm-hmm. So it's semantics. A meeting is a informational meeting. Is there going to be a vote taken at the end of this meeting with respect to any sanctions taken to Mr. Pachinski, such as referring to the Ethics Commission? It is its reputation, its integrity is at stake. You should be given an advance notice of that. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I don't think we're presuming an outcome of the meeting. First thing we needed to do is we felt compelled to bring Mr. Pachinski in and notify him of our concerns about his behavior.
If the culmination of this meeting then is to make a recommendation or to take a vote or a motion to refer to the Ethics Commission, then that's something that should be discussed prior to the commencement of this meeting.
Well, you really can't discuss it before the meeting because then you'd be in
violation of
the meeting law. And the notice that he received was the notice that is required by the statute and is the notice that has been given in cases where he sat as a selectman. The statute does not require you to be specific with respect to the subject matter, which it was, and certainly the statute does not require that you set out in advance what potential votes there could be, because at the point you're preparing the notice, you don't know what those alternatives are.
I would suggest that he should have been advised with the range of options that this board has. He was not advised of that for violation of his rights.
Just for the record, we actually advised him of that range of possibilities at a previous meeting.
Was it done in writing?
No.
Just note my objection.
Pardon?
Just note my objection.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to continue this hearing and bring the witnesses in. It might prevent some long-term litigation.
I would go forward.
Go forward?
Yeah.
Okay. So is the board comfortable with moving forward at this point?
Yes.
Okay. So the board, as chair of the board, I want to remind Mr. Pachinski that you're an elected representative and a servant of the people of the town of Hadley, and that as such you carry a higher expectation of proper and professional conduct in your dealings around this town. Your recent actions create an additional burden for Hadley's town government. Improper conduct by elected officials impairs efficiency, productivity, and morale among your fellow select board members. It erodes public confidence in its elected officials. It distracts our community leaders from the important work that needs to get done, and it unnecessarily consumes time and resources of town departments. So the summary of the allegations concerning October 15th, complaints allege that you were working, driving buses to transport students from Amherst to the Young Men's Club of Hadley, and then back again on Saturday, October 15th, where a sponsored event called Oktoberfest, I believe, was taking place at the Young Men's Club. Shortly after 3 o'clock, Mr. Pipchinsky entered the grounds by showing a badge and indicating that he was a police commissioner and not paying the cover charge required for admission. Subsequently, Mr. Pipchinsky was confronted by club personnel and Mr. John Michkowski Jr. And he confronted you presumably because your membership at the club had been terminated and he asked you to leave the property. You indicated that it was a private event and because you were a police commissioner, you had the right to inspect alcohol, any place where alcohol was being served. When spoken to by a Hadley police officer who happened to be there as well, Sergeant Mitch Cook, you continued to insist that it was you were a police commissioner and that you had a right to inspect the alcohol service. You then left the grounds after speaking with the police officer. Subsequent to this happening, the select board received a verbal complaint, two letters of complaint, and a statement by Sergeant Cook. And at this time, that's what we have in front of us. That's what we have, what's been reported to us. And I guess we're interested in your comment. What you have to say.
If I can respond on his behalf. Mr. Pipchinsky is a member of this board. As a member of this board, he also sits as a police commissioner and a license commissioner with responsibilities of overseeing the granting of alcohol licenses. In the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, any license commissioner has the right to go onto any premises where alcohol is being served. He does not have the right to make any arrest. He has the right to make to make observations. And after making those observations, has the right to come back and make a written report to this board or a written report to the police department. The fact that Mr. Pipchinsky did not make any written reports would suggest as indicative that he did not observe any obvious, clear violations of any liquor violations laws. And the members of the Young Men's Club seem to think that this is a retaliatory action on Mr. Pipchinsky's part. I would suggest to them and to this board and to the citizens of this community that if Mr. Pipchinsky was truly trying to be retaliatory and being vindictive because he was no longer a member of the club, that he would have found a violation and would have submitted something in writing. The fact that he did not do that, to me, is indicative that he was on the premises in his capacity. He was acting as a school bus driver, strike that, as a bus driver transporting students from UMass to the Young Men's Club for an Oktoberfest. While he was there, he opted to take the opportunity to go inside, walk around, look around, see what he was observing. He has that right. As a police commissioner, he did have a badge from when he was a member of this board 27 years ago. Since this incident, he has spoken to the police chief. He told the police chief that he has discarded that badge into the river or the stream that runs behind his property. He's no longer in possession of that. I again reiterate that there's nothing vindictive in Mr. Pipchinsky's behavior on the day in question. The reports indicate he was loud, he was yelling. I would suggest every member of this board who has known Mr. Pipchinsky for any period of time, he speaks in a very loud manner. I wear hearing aids. When he's in my office, I had to take them off. I'm still asking to please tone it down, and his tone of voice is still outrageous. So it's his natural way of expressing himself, not being disrespectful. I think he's concerned. He respects this board, he respects the citizenry of Hadley, and he wants to continue in his capacity, and he will continue in his capacity. But while he's on this board, it's unfair for members of the Young Men's Club to say, you can't come on our property. They're selling alcohol, they're serving alcohol. One member of the club suggested that, well, if you're going to come on and do an inspection, give us a heads up. Give me a heads up that I'm going to be coming by to inspect to see if you're complying with the alcohol laws. That'd be like the police saying we're going to do a sting operation. We're going to call you up and say, by the way, we're doing a sting operation tonight, Mr. Club. Make sure everything's in order. Mr. Pipchinsky was there as a bus driver, had to use the facilities, went onto the premises. He did not pay. You're absolutely correct. He did not pay. But I would suggest as a member of the License Commission and a police commissioner, he does not have to do that. The badge is gone. Mr. Pipchinsky understands that they have an error in judgment. If they think he was a police commissioner, I was under the impression that every member of this board had a badge. His address, which he tells me, was from his previous days on his board, and it's no longer in existence. At this point, I'd like Mr. Potinsky to remind this board, tell this board, as well as the citizenry of Hadley, what his prior history is with the town of Hadley and his family's history.
Could we play the tape first to show what I thought about the Young Men's Club at the testimonial?
There is a tape that lasts probably less than 90 seconds, where Mr. Potinsky was the master of ceremonies, is that correct?
Correct, for Ron Baresca's testimonial, Mrs. Baresca's son that just passed away 2 days ago.
Which happened a short time before this Oktoberfest event?
It happened on June 12th, long before, 2 months prior to these incidents.
And this tape goes to the allegation that there's a vindictive vein with Mr. Potinsky trying to retaliate against the club.
Okay, ready? Is there gonna be any narration from anyone?
No.
Okay. Audio off. Play.
Try to fast forward that, sir.
What's mine now? Yeah.
Yeah, fast forward. I thought I'm ready.
Come on, Dennis, you gotta do this.
It's really a testimony to what he's done for this community. It's about community giving something back to somebody. So it's my pleasure to present a citation from the House of Representatives. It says, "Be it hereby known to all, the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to Ronald F. Baresca in recognition of Ronald F. Baresca Day and your dedication and service."
Is going to be Sean Gould. He's the president of the Young Men's Club, and first of all, I'd like to thank him for letting us use these wonderful facilities and all that he does in his club for the youth of Hadley. They let the school use these ball fields and soccer fields free of charge and maintain them for them. They bring their JV teams over here and utilize the fields. Many other activities. They donate the pavilion for many of the children in this town that have major diseases, and they have fundraisers here to help them, and they do fabulous things for this community. Again, Sean Duhl, president of Young Men's Club.
How are you guys all doing today? Glad you guys came out. Thank you for your support. Again, yes, I'm Sean Gould, president of the club. Kenny asked me a couple weeks ago to speak here today, and I was honored.
Sorry, everybody watching. The career is blown out.
So. Okay.
Do not take a moment, sir, to fill the board and the citizens of Hadley.
Can you pause
histories.
For a moment, make sure he has the audio on?
Yes, it is.
So, the citizens of Hadley, what your position is, what your history is with this town and your family's history.
Okay. My grandmother and grandfather moved to Hadley. They were immigrants from Poland. And they moved to Hadley in 1904. My grandfather, Andrew, met his future wife from Poland, another immigrant in Holyoke, and they got married in Mella Della Rosa Church, and then they moved to Anel at 301 River Drive. This is the home now of Edward McCretsky, and it was a home that was moved from Lebert.
I'm going to ask you, Madam Chairman, now you have full control.
Mm-hmm.
1904 was 100-some-odd years ago.
All right.
We'll be here for a long time.
Yeah.
If we have to listen to 100 years of history.
It isn't going to be that long, sir. But I can skip all that to pacify you.
Try to summarize it, Tom.
Yeah.
I will. Our family has resided in Hadley for 6 generations. There's some families that actually came over on the Mayflower that live in Hadley. During that time, some of my relative, one Adolf Pipsinski, has worked for the town over 54 years during that time. He was a police chief, and he ended his career as a bus driver. I got him his license because I was transportation coordinator in Hadley for 25 years. During that time, Pipsinski was principal of Hopkins Academy, and later he became a acting superintendent of the schools. We had highway and water superintendents, sewer superintendents. We had firemen in Hadley. We have teachers and coaches, finance committee member, which I was, and selectman. Our family are not takers, we're givers. We've given more to this town probably than any other name you could come up with. Presently, right now, in the school system, we have teachers. We have someone that's on the highway sewer commission running that. We have firemen and myself as a select person. We love Hadley and its soil, and that will never change.
Just, Donald, for the record, I want to be clear here. We're not concerned about your family's behavior. We know you come from a long line of fine family members. However, we're here to address your specific behavior.
I realize that, but you're dragging my name through the mud, and you're dragging my whole family through the mud now. And that's what I'm very upset about. And everybody in my family is upset about that.
Mm-hmm.
The way you're treating our name in this board is.
I have to say something. I can't sit here any longer, Donald. In all the years that I have lived in town, and in the 14 years that I've been on the board, no other selectman, acting selectman, has ever used their badge in any such way that they felt that they could go on to any piece of property and act as a commissioner, a police commissioner, or a liquor commissioner. They have never done that, and I don't know anybody that's ever been a selectman that's done that. You have really upset me by doing this. I've had my badge for over 14 years, and I have never produced it to get out of anything or to use it for anything, and I've never gone to any establishment and said, I'm a police commissioner. I have a right to be here to see what's going on in this establishment. That isn't what it's used for. That badge is only used to cross the line if we have a disaster. It's to be used as to let us to go through to help if the police department or the fire department needs us to see something. It's not for us to be out there looking at what other establishments are doing. I've never done that before. I'm very disappointed, and it's not necessarily, and it's only that fact that you felt the need that you had to use that badge for that purpose. You didn't have to do that.
Well, and the other pertinent fact here is that we have a strong police chief, and a very competent one. And to the extent any one of us had any concerns, at a minimum, I would think that either the town administrator or the chair of the select board would be notified that there was a concern. And the chief of police would be notified as well. So I think an error in judgment certainly took place if, in fact, you know, hearing the statement from your attorney indicating that you felt that you had a right to do that. But to Joyce's point, it isn't an action that any one of us would have even have occurred to take, given the fact that we have a chief of police who would handle such matters. And again, why didn't you communicate, if you had a concern about the Young Men's Club, why didn't it occur to you that you should recuse yourself from the situation, knowing that you had been asked not to be on their premises? Again, that's a private matter. It's not the business of the board. But why would you not have asked another board member or the chief of police to look into the alcohol if you had a legitimate concern about it?
Are you asking me a question?
Yes.
This concern was raised when he was present at the day. He didn't know of it a day in advance. He didn't know of it a week in advance. Mm-hmm. He was bringing students back and forth. And he began to notice there were varying degrees of intoxication. And that raised a concern for him, which caused him to want to go onto the premises to see what was going on. The fact that he never wrote a report, never contacted the chief, is suggestive of the fact that he didn't observe anything on the premises.
Exactly. I mean, we had fire there, we had EMS there, and we had police there. So I'm sure if there was a matter, there would be a record of it in the police station also at that point.
That's correct.
Can I ask a question? Is there a statutory reference or a bylaw reference or some other reference to Donald being a police commissioner?
I would like to answer your question.
That'd be great.
And I'd pass these out for the board and anyone else that wants one, please take one, and I'll explain the badge. So I'm answering Selectman Chumglow's question and not yours.
Donald, you haven't been recognized yet, so counsel, please continue.
And again, it could come from you, sir, or counsel. Is there a bylaw that talks about select people being a police commissioner?
I don't know either.
All over the state.
Is there a statute that talks about select board members being a police commissioner?
There are some chapter and sections of the law, I believe.
Okay.
Bylaw.
I haven't been able to find that.
I searched.
Bylaw of Hadley.
Okay.
In the state statute.
Can somebody give me a state statute that empowers select persons to be, quote, police commissioners?
I guess my answer to you is you sat on the hearing, 26 hours of testimony,
yep,
when I acted as a police commissioner.
No, sir, you're wrong.
What was I?
You were
a select board member.
Yes, sir.
But when you talk about the badge, this is what the whole incident is about.
Sir, I don't want to escalate it. I just...
I've got to answer Mrs. Chunglow.
I sat here for a minute or so with sound, no sound.
Mm-hmm.
Do you or your counsel know of any statute that designates Board of Selectmen members as police commissioners?
Are there statutes for sewer commissioners, license commissioners, which we are? Do you have statutes for that?
Sir, again, it's not my role, so...
It's not mine either, but I can throw out garbage, too.
I believe his understanding is as a member of this board, which appoints police officers, the semantics of the title go with the police commissioner, someone who's appointing members of the police department, like we just did earlier tonight, where two officers were appointed to the force by this board.
We're the hiring and firing authority for the town, so we deal with all personnel matters, but that doesn't give us any authority over the chief of police. He's the highest law enforcement official we have in town.
Well, there's no one suggesting something about my client that he has a higher authority than the police chief. He's not suggesting that. He knows he does not have arrest authorities. That's never been a position taken by him.
A perfect example of a badge is when you look at our building inspector. Wherever he goes, he has a badge on his belt, or he has a badge on his shirt. All it does is allow you entry and prove your identification. That's all. He has no arresting powers. I have no arresting powers. But it allows him the identification he needs to do his inspections.
He has enforcement powers with his badge. He has laws.
He has no arresting.
He has enforcement.
That's what I'm saying, no arresting powers.
He is an enforcement officer, and that's why he has a badge. Not a police badge, it's an enforcement badge where he can, he dictates if somebody is not going by what the bylaw says, he has the right to bring them in or to fine them. He has the right to do that, to fine. We don't have the right to do that as a police commissioner. We don't have a right to arrest anybody. We
don't
have anything.
He doesn't either. He has to make
the
allegation.
He has the right to fine them.
Are you saying this is a police badge that you carry?
No, it's not.
I said it wasn't too.
No.
I said it's not a police badge. It's nothing to do with a police badge. It's an official badge for a Board of Selectmen. Simply that. It says on the badge, Board of Selectmen, Commissioner. It doesn't say anywhere on this badge, police. Nothing.
But you shouldn't have used it in an authoritative manner.
I'm using it as a commissioner and Board of Selectmen. I never said...
You still had no business doing that.
Well, it's no different than the building inspector.
You had no business going on a piece of property and inspecting. Do you go to the Legion and inspect there?
I'm not inspecting. I went in to use the facilities, first of all. I've been driving bus for 4 hours. And then they wouldn't let me in because I didn't pay $40 to get in?
The bathrooms weren't even open. There were sandy cans on the property at that day. The bathrooms were locked that day.
I went out and they used the sandy can, but there were long lines. I was on the premises probably 10 minutes and I left because I didn't want any altercations.
Okay, so can we just kind of bring this back up to maybe 10,000 feet? Again, to Kemp's point, we're not here to get into the nitty-gritty of exactly what, who said what and what happened.
Madam Chair, you're making all these allegations and none of the witnesses are here tonight to back up what you're saying. I would love to ask those witnesses these questions, and I didn't bring up the allegations about all the offenses that went on because I knew they would say it was retaliation.
Excuse me, I was speaking. So the reason that we're here and that we're having this conversation is because we have been here before. We have been here, more than one occasion, and this dates back to concerns and conversations that...
You just violated the ethics. According to the town administrator, you're not supposed to bring up anything from the past that we voted in an executive session, and you just brought up the past.
Donald, may I continue?
Which would put you in violation.
The point being that we have had multiple conversations, and I'm trying to date back to the point that you came on the select board, wherein I was named chair, that we tried to sit down and have conversations to make it clear what roles and responsibilities were of the select board. Those conversations all took place in open session. We had discussions about code of conduct. The reason that we're here is because this has been a culmination, and the concern that I have, and I'll only speak for myself, is that you're not hearing us. You're not, that you continue to act independently and act alone. And that really concerns me.
I guess what concerns me, I had a 3-page statement. But the first thing in there, this has become, I was involved in a very heated campaign. You campaigned against me. You put up signs for my opponent. And that has continued from this day. You even went at a hearing and said, I'd never sit down and have a beer with him. And this is what it is. It's political. It's not anything I'm doing wrong. It's political on your point, and you keep pushing it. I've offered you the olive branch numerous times. You refuse to take it. And you keep making it more political and calling the young minks up. I asked the administrator if there was any written testimony, and he said no. Then it was solicited by somebody on this board to make some written testimony. And I believe it was you.
Well,
who else could it be?
It was
the first time. So you solicited the Young Men's Club to give you written testimony. Again, politically, to annihilate me and try to get me to quit this job, which I will not do.
Well, first of all, that's quite speculative on your part, but you also must know that one of the things that we talk about as a select board is that if people are going to make complaints that we won't discuss complaints unless they're put in writing. We collectively agreed on that.
There weren't any in writing until you asked them to put one in. I asked the administrator that, and he can confirm that. There weren't any until you solicited them for one. Nobody had any written complaints for that first hearing.
Does anybody have any questions for...
I'd like to bring the people in that wrote these articles, and I'd like to have them examined and cross-examined as per the request of the attorney, because the difference between what these letters say and what is being speculated is night and day to me, and I'd like to get that confirmed.
And then I hate to say it, if they come in, it's going to bring out into the open everything that happened at that concert. And the condition the children were in, I can bring in 8 bus drivers that will testify to the condition of the students at that concert. And the condition of our buses. They were thrown up on, urinated on, grabbing the drivers, women, and this is all going to become part of it, and I don't think we want that.
I want the truth, Donald. That's all I care.
Well, then I think I need it. The truth will come out.
Excellent.
That way. I agree with you.
Okay.
But I'm not initiating that. You are.
I am. Absolutely.
Okay. And then that opens up everything that's going on at that club.
I take full responsibility for that.
Okay. So, counselor, options in front of us right now. Continue this.
Well, it sounds like you're making a motion to continue to another date for the purpose of having...
I would like the rights of Mr. Pipchinski fully vetted.
Right.
I'd like the attorney to have every opportunity to cross-examine at his request.
Okay.
And I would like the people who wrote these letters to have every opportunity to come before us, speak to them, and talk to the issues there.
Okay.
There's a lot of things that are in there that are cited as case in point and example that they don't have a chance to cross-examine. I completely agree with you. Well, let's get them in.
Somebody should second the motion, and you should take a vote on it.
I would like to make a motion then.
Second motion to
bring in the letter writer.
They have a continuance and bring in the witnesses.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do we need a roll call, or we just not? We don't.
You're in open session.
Would you suggest the ones that are members along with the town clerk to give the attorney general's office a call and let them know our membership with the Young Men's Club at this point or not?
I'm not sure I follow, but I think
we'll speak to
what I will do is I will once again review the documents and see who I think is appropriate. Council wants to subpoena witnesses, then you can subpoena witnesses.
No, as far as us,
you should file your disclosure statement with the town clerk, and I think that would be sufficient.
For now, at this point, okay.
Right.
Okay, so any further discussion on the motion made and seconded? If not, all in favor?
I have a question. Will that allow us to bring our witnesses in?
So we would expect that they would be identified in advance.
Okay. Well, first we'll do the date second. Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and then we need to set the date for that.
I'm sorry, is that your name?
No.
What was the vote?
You said no then?
No.
Oh, so 3-1.
I said no.
3-2.
Can you vote on your own? Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so we need to set a date for that?
I'd rather do a separate day, too. Don't you think?
Mm-hmm. You mean not on a select board meeting?
Not on a select board meeting.
Yep.
How many hours do you think we'll need?
2.
So you need 2, I need probably 2, so 4 hours.
4 hours. Okay. So we'd likely start at what, 6 o'clock?
Sounds fine.
Okay.
I would think it would be much longer if it took us 26 hours for just the...
I was thinking the same thing, sir, because I'm not quite sure whether...
It's very time-consuming and very costly for everyone.
Exactly.
Did you say 26 hours? What?
I think the selectman is referring to an issue that was in executive session.
Oh, yeah.
And then Councilman...
Let's start off with 4 hours and we'll see where that goes.
Okay.
KP Law is still, they made a decision saying that I cannot be indemnified because it's a criminal case. That was a fabrication by the town administrator. It is not a criminal case. There are no charges pending for anything. It's a civil case. And I would like to know if I'm going to be indemnified. If I'm not, then the board members shouldn't be indemnified either.
Sir, I think your request was to be provided counsel in the, for the State Ethics Commission. And I believe...
No, it's for everything, because that's how it started.
Let's the only thing... Well, I want to answer his question so that the public knows. There was a request for indemnification, which included representation by the town's law firm to represent you in matters which included the State Ethics Commission. And you were advised that under the case of Triplett versus Oxford, that it would be inappropriate for the town to pay what is essentially your private obligation. That's what I understood you were told.
No. No.
Excuse me, you're not part of this?
I was represented and I was indemnified.
Okay.
Okay, so we're looking for a date. So I would assume we're going to have to push it out a couple of weeks because we need to notify individuals.
How about the 29th, Tuesday the 29th?
I get a question. Who's going to pay for all this? I hope not us, the taxpayers.
What's the date?
November 29th.
What's that?
That's Tuesday.
Be ashamed of yourself. Disgusting. Disgusting boy, bringing this cost to the taxpayers.
Keep going, John.
Get ashamed of yourself.
Keep going. Have a heart attack.
That wasn't called for. That was not called for. This is just a joke. Just for the kangaroo court,
29.
I'm sorry.
Is it 29th?
And I felt that way the first time I came in here. You were just out to get him.
I'm about to be part of this. 29th, David.
Yes, ma'am.
At 6 o'clock?
6 p.m. Is that all right with Mr. Wharton?
It's a lot for me to speak up. Can I speak up?
Mr. Wharton?
I'm sorry?
Was that okay with you at the 29th?
Tuesday.
I don't have my equipment book with me. I thought this was going to resolve tonight. I apologize. If it's not, I'll call counsel first thing in the morning, but I'll make it work.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, and now will that take the form of an actual formal hearing? hearing notices on that?
Yeah, we can characterize it that way. This, yeah, this is a procedure that can be used.
Okay. Okay, all right, so we will continue this then to November 29th at 6 p.m. Okay.
Thank you.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
So we're still in open session for regular select board. So any final announcements or anything before we close for the evening?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay. So you made a motion to adjourn.
I did.
Second.
Second. I apologize for that last comment I made also.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Night, everybody.